Good afternoon, everyone. We'll just be getting started in a couple of minutes. Thank you for joining us today. We're also streaming on YouTube. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. My name is Lee Cully, and I serve as the Director of Disability Resources and Services at the University of Pittsburgh. I'll be moderating the session today, along with my colleague, Angie Bedford-Jack, who serves as the Digital Accessibility Coordinator in the Office of Diversity and Inclusion at the University of Pittsburgh. We're pleased that you could join us today for this very important topic, Holes in the Safety Net, the Forgotten Needs of People with Disabilities Under Quarantine. A session in the Town Hall series through the Office of Diversity and Inclusion. You will have an opportunity to ask questions, so please feel free to enter any questions that you may have throughout the session in the Q&A in the Zoom webinar. We will have an opportunity towards the end of our discussion to address some of the questions that you may have. Current statistics indicate that nearly 1 in 4 Americans live with a disability. And as we approach the 30th anniversary of the passage of the Americans with Disabilities Act, we can reflect on the modest but very positive and important changes in our country with regard to individuals with disabilities. The COVID-19 pandemic, however, revealed some significant gaps in services, resources, and support for one of society's most vulnerable populations. Advocacy and allyship in the age of COVID-19 is an important topic, and today we come together with a terrific panel of professionals to discuss the forgotten needs of people with disabilities under quarantine. I am pleased to introduce our panelists for today. After each introduction, I would ask that each panelist share a bit about yourself and how you came to work around disability. First, I would like to introduce Dr. Brad DiCiano. Dr. DiCiano is rehabilitation physician and bioengineer. He is an associate professor in the Department of Physical Medicine and Rehabilitation at the University of Pittsburgh School of Medicine. He serves as the medical director and COO of the Human Engineering Research Laboratories, the medical director of the UPMC Center for Assistive Technology, and the director of the UPMC Adult Spina Bifida Clinic. Welcome, Dr. DiCiano.
Thanks, Lee. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm really happy to be here today. My introduction to getting involved with disability and disability medicine really stems back from a history of working with the Muscular Dystrophy Association. When I was a high school student, I did a lot of volunteer work and started taking on more roles in that organization, running summer camps for kids with disabilities. And I knew that I wanted to go to medical school, but didn't find the field of physical medicine and rehabilitation, which is my specialty, until I was actually in medical school when I started doing research. So that's how I got involved.
Great, thank you. Next, I would like to introduce Catherine Getchell. Catherine serves as Director of the Office of Disability Resources at Carnegie Mellon University. Catherine's office coordinates academic and housing accommodations for approximately 1,000 students with a variety of physical, cognitive, emotional, and sensory disabilities. In addition to working directly with students, Catherine provides training, professional development opportunities, consultation, and advocacy across campus around issues of disability and accessibility. Prior to coming to Carnegie Mellon in 2016, Catherine worked as a vocational rehabilitation counselor and then district administrator for the Pennsylvania Office of Vocational Rehabilitation, assisting individuals with disabilities to obtain and maintain employment and independence. Catherine has a master's degree in rehabilitation science with a concentration in counseling from the University of Pittsburgh. Welcome, Catherine.
Thank you so much. Good afternoon, everyone. Just to supplement what Lee shared, my kind of driving professional force throughout my career has been an interest in promoting the independence and ability and self-advocacy skills of people with disabilities. And really above all that, raising the level of expectations that people have of people with disabilities. And CMU is an incredible place to do that. We have exceptionally capable students with and without disabilities, but certainly our students with disabilities, exceptionally capable students who accomplish amazing things at Carnegie Mellon and throughout the world when just provided with some customized supports and accommodations that allow them to do that. So that's really what motivates my work, and I'm very excited to be a part of this panel. Thanks for having me.
Thanks, Catherine. Next, I'd like to introduce Heather Tomko. Heather is the Outreach Coordinator at the University of Pittsburgh's National Center on Family Support and a recent Pitt Masters of Public Health graduate. In July 2018, Heather was crowned Miss Wheelchair USA and spent the year promoting her platform, Increasing Inclusion for People with Disabilities into Their Communities. As a woman with spinal muscular atrophy and neuromuscular disease, Heather is passionate about disability advocacy and access. She serves on the board of directors of CLASS, a local disability resources organization, the board of the Warhol Museum, and AT&T's National Advisory Panel on Access and Aging. She is founder of Accessible Universe, an organization focused on disability advocacy, education, and representation. Heather was the winner of the 2018 Dick Thornburg Disability Service Award, which is awarded to a student at the University of Pittsburgh who has made a difference in the lives of children and adults with disabilities. She also blogs at The Heather Report, where she talks about her life and what it's like to live with a disability. Welcome, Heather.
Thank you so much for having me. I will keep this short because I feel like a lot of what I do is already in my bio. But what you can tell a lot more, obviously, in person than you can on Zoom is that I use a wheelchair, and I always have. So I've been a self-advocate for my whole life because I had to. But in the past few years, I kind of realized that I needed to get involved in advocacy more than just for myself if I wanted to see the changes happen that I felt like were needed. And my big push is always that accessibility be included from the outset rather than as an afterthought, which is how I feel it often is today. So,
thanks, Heather. Welcome. And finally, I would like to introduce Kenneth DeHaan. Dr. DeHaan started his financial career in wealth management at BNY Mellon, but he discovered another hidden passion along the way, which is teaching. His professorship began at the University of Pittsburgh, but he has also taught at other higher education institutions throughout his career, including, but not limited to, University College in London, Waynesburg University, Community College of Allegheny County, and Pennsylvania State University. Today, he is a professor at Gallaudet University. Kenneth brings a blend of unique perspectives through the lens of language, pedagogy, and administration to his place of practice. This unique skill set is amplified through his doctorate studies in higher education management. Kenneth has taught a variety of courses related to language, education, and culture for various organizations, schools, and colleges. His methods are informed by research and pedagogical practices. On the variety of courses Kenneth has taught, his passion lies within social justice, policy, and language. Outside of the classroom, Kenneth takes on multiple leadership and consulting roles, including team management and high-level planning and implementation. Welcome, Kenneth.
Hi, thank you so much for having me here today. I'm very excited to be here. And my story really is that, you know, my whole life, I knew I wanted to be involved in the business world and finances in some way. And then sure enough, I became successful with that at BNY Mellon. And I realized this was maybe not what I wanted to do. And after some soul searching, you know, after thinking about this my whole life, you know, being active in the community, and the community was a very important part, and language and culture are such a part of community. And being involved in the community really fed that hidden passion. So it was more of a, you know, policy and social justice and linguistics slant, but pedagogy, I was curious about how that fit into that world and how could I could support that world through my community. And so that's how I ended up here today.
Great, thank you very much. Angie, I'm gonna turn it over to you.
Thanks, Lee. Hi, everyone. As Lee said, I'm Angie Bedford-Jack, and as you can hear from the panelists, we have a wide variety of successful folks here, and I'm hopeful that we'll learn quite a bit from them over the course of the next hour and a half. So we'll dive in with our first question. You know, during this time with COVID, I think it has been a struggle for everyone. But obviously we know that there are greater risks and challenges for different groups of people. So I'm curious if you all could talk about, what do you see as some of the greatest risks or barriers to people with disabilities during this time?
I'm starting if it's okay to throw a whole bunch of things onto the table. Over the last couple of months, we've heard a lot from advocacy groups and patients and people who work with those with disabilities. And so I have a whole laundry list of things that have come to mind, and I'll just throw a few of them out. But I think hospital policies and ethics rules are a big one. Issues with home care workers, accessing food services and supplies, telemedicine, and then public transportation. So those are just some of the things that I think come to the top of things that I would like to highlight. And I think they present both challenges, but also opportunities where we can do better and learn from some places that are doing very good things in those areas.
Jump in. This is Catherine. I'm going to take Brad's approach and just throw a lot of things on the table. And this is from the lens through my students that I work with, and also my own personal experience as a person with a disability. I'm totally blind. Social isolation is a big thing that our students have encountered. They're used to being on a busy university campus, having a lot of contacts in person, and now they're, you know, experiencing a lot of social isolation that, I'll talk about this a bit in a bit, but has a huge impact on mental health. Certainly access to, for people with disabilities who might need some assistance or support in their home, accessing that support because they might be more vulnerable to care providers who are coming in from the outside. As Brad mentioned, access to medical care. It's been very, very difficult for my students who need different kinds of medical care, medication, therapy, any number of things to access that, because medical providers are understandably prioritizing care for individuals with COVID and COVID-related conditions. And that has really limited the medical access that our students have. Even sometimes ability to obtain some basic supplies, you know, having not being able necessarily to go out to the store to get what you need. And sometimes that's available for delivery, but delivery is taking some time. So there's lots of things related to that. Reduced access to employment. Many of our people with disabilities find themselves being those most vulnerable to the huge job losses that we've seen. They may have to self-quarantine longer than others, because they may have conditions that make them more vulnerable to COVID. And even as we start to open up, they may feel as though they're not quite ready to do that. With the heavy access to or heavy reliance on Zoom and other kinds of communications, I'm guessing Kenneth is going to talk about this, but access to interpreting, access to captioning for those who are deaf or hard of hearing, we being folks who are hearing, taking for granted that we can just jump on a Zoom call, but that's not as easy to do if you're requiring captioning or interpreting. That facilities may be very accustomed to providing that in an in-person setting and not so accustomed to providing it in a remote setting or video conference setting. But I want to really focus on mental health. That's something that our students have experienced a dramatic set of challenges, especially if they already had a pre-existing mental health condition. They're finding that has been exacerbated by some triggers of anxiety, triggers of depression. And then getting into executive functioning. So for our students with cognitive disabilities, our students with maybe ADHD or traumatic brain injury, sometimes students with mental health challenges, things like time management, self-management, goal setting, staying motivated, having structure in your schedule, these are all things that have taken, have changed in a major way for all of us. And that's very impactful for people who rely on sometimes some built-in structure into their day. And that's just an increased challenge that our students have absolutely experienced. So just throwing a whole bunch of things out there.
This is Heather. I want to kind of add on to some of the things that have already been mentioned. I think, so I am one of the people that are at higher risk for severe cases of COVID. One of the things about SMA is that all of my muscles are weak, which means that my lungs are also weaker. So I could, if I got COVID, I could get very dangerously sick. So I have taken the precautions incredibly seriously. And I think the challenges have kind of changed as the pandemic has changed. So at first it was this, everyone everywhere was getting groceries delivered. So we were as well, that's great. But things like toilet paper and paper towels that were being so rationed and were only available in stores, that meant that we couldn't get any at all. And luckily we had friends and family who live in the area and were willing to drop it off for us on our front porch. But if you don't live somewhere and have that built-in support system of people that you know, you really have to make this incredible risk calculation of how do I balance my need for these basic supplies with my need to stay healthy and not be potentially exposed. I make that same risk calculation with home care workers. I have a mix of family caregivers and paid caregivers. And I have right now one paid caregiver who has been with me for years, and I trust her, and I know that she's taking the precautions seriously. But that means that because it's only her, not every possible shift of my needs is filled. And so I had to say, I can't risk bringing in a new person to my house and my environment, but that means that home life is more stressful because you're hobbling together everyone's very busy schedules in one house. And then as things start to open up and there's this kind of attitude that people are tired of being home and they want to go back to really the old normal, that means that I have to be even more careful and cautious because people are not taking it as seriously as they were a few months ago. So now grocery deliveries aren't really an issue anymore. but I'm worried about how long I will have to stay home when and make these decisions now of, well, things are open, but not really for me because I can't trust that other people are still taking the precautions. So it shifted as the pandemic has shifted as well.
And this is Kenny. Yeah, Kenneth here, so I'll jump in. Thank you, Catherine. Yeah, you're right. You mentioned some important points and correct. Yeah, there's a laundry list of different issues, so it's significant. So before we can really understand the problem that deaf people are facing, we have to understand some background context for that. So before I get into that, I wanted to clarify. So when I sign deaf, the sign deaf, and that word deaf means prelingually deaf people. It might mean postlingually deaf people, someone who was still young when they lost their hearing, people who have become deaf as they've aged. So it's, there are a variety of reasons that causes their deafness and it poses different issues for some. So for example, to understand, you know, how can we resolve that problem today? We can't just do a, you know, stick a band-aid on all these situations as individual issues. We have to understand the background and what caused the problem in the first place and what we're really facing. So I can identify three big issues, really. So for example, and I'll use Pennsylvania as one of these, as the example. So Act 57, for example, requires that interpreters have to be registered with the Office of the Deaf and Hard of Hearing, ODHH. So currently, they have a database that they keep that will show you a list of about 383 interpreters that are registered with the state. So those 383 interpreters may not be an updated list. You've got to contact the person that maintains that database and see. Some of those individuals may be retired and they have not informed the state to take them off the list, or some of them might be off for a temporary part-time. Some of them might be part-time in general. Some might be freelance. There are a variety of different specialties and different certifications that interpreters work in different environments. And really, so that 383 number might not be accurate. It might be less than that. And so if we want to look at, you know, really an exact number of certified interpreters, you know, for K-12 students, you can only pull up 28 interpreters that are willing, that are certified and willing to work in K-12 environments in Pennsylvania. So if you look at the Pennsylvania Department of Education and you look at the list, I can see that we have at least 3,000 deaf people in the state of Pennsylvania in K-12 environments, students. So that is a huge gap for who has access to enough interpreters and the number of deaf students that we have. So that's one issue. The second issue that we have is that if we want certified K-12 interpreters, then you've got to have the EIPA test. And what that is the Educational Interpreters Performance Examination Assessment. So if they take that assessment, then they get a score from 1 to 5. And on that exam, they have to have a minimum score of 3.5 in Pennsylvania. So if I look at the EIPA of 3.5 and what that actually means, what it'll say is that a 3.5 is equivalent to, they demonstrate knowledge of basic, and I mean basic vocabulary. However, they will lack the vocabulary for more complex and technical vocabulary or topic or academic topics. So that's a problem, because if you've got a teacher who's giving a lecture or teaching a class and the hearing students and their hearing peers are getting 100% of that information because they all speak the same language. If it's being funneled through an interpreter that only has some, you know, there's some things that get lost in translation. Is the deaf student getting the same equivalent amount of input? When it gets, you know, processed through the interpreter, some of that information is bound to be lost. And the output that gets to the student, if that interpreter is qualified, it might be, if they have a 3.5, that's not a great score. You know, are they familiar with that academic topic? What amount of information is being received? It's even less. So the student is automatically at a disadvantage in this situation. However, again, there are many good interpreters. So, you know, interpreting is a tough field. So, but at the same time, we have many interpreters who should not be interpreting. So the third issue that comes up is that many public schools, many IUs, the intermediate unit system that we have in Pennsylvania, many of the teachers that involved in that are not always appropriately trained on how to work with a deaf student and how to have that child in their classroom. Many of them have different degrees. They may have a special ed degree. They may have a deaf education degree. But the problem is that the deaf education degree does not necessarily mean that they know how to work with a deaf child in their classroom, because often different colleges and universities, their curriculum that they use to train teachers and what they teach for deaf education, we find often that they're using special needs framework in order to frame working with deaf students. And that framework in and of itself is a big problem, because if we want to look globally at all of this, they have one thing in common, and that is English, that, you know, everyone needs to speak and hear and write English. For deaf students, spoken English has its own unique grammar and set of linguistic skills separate from ASL. So you have completely two different language systems within education. Now we're trying to apply a special needs framework to a deaf child, and that becomes problematic. So often the teachers are typically, they'll tell you, I know ASL, but they may have taken one or two classes of ASL, and that is not equivalent. That's equivalent to two semesters, and you cannot be fluent in any language in two semesters worth of work. I've taught ASL for 10 years, and I can tell you it's for all languages, not just ASL. So these are three really big issues that we're facing right now. And my point in saying all of this is that the problem that we're facing currently during this coronavirus pandemic is not new. This has been on an ongoing struggle for a long time, but the problem that we're facing now is that it's amplified. Because all of this has happened and now we're transitioning to remote learning, to online learning. And currently, you know, the safety net that you've mentioned, I don't think we have one at all. It's not one with holes. There just isn't one there. Kids are just dropping. So the biggest problem I think we have here is language deprivation. And so, for example, there are a few examples of the issues that we've been facing. Like Catherine mentioned, Zoom meetings. There's Zoom fatigue. Deaf students, children in a classroom staring at a screen and trying to figure out the puzzle and piece the puzzle together of what they're trying to learn. And now they're on the internet trying to use that information to add to this puzzle and fill in more gaps. I have to ask the audience, you know, to think about, try, you know, putting your TV on and you turn the sound off and just read the captions. And, you know, now when there's no audio cues, you don't know when there's a pause. You don't know when there's a break in a sentence. You don't know necessarily if it indicates who's speaking. Often the captioning doesn't tell you which character is speaking. It becomes a much more complicated task. And for deaf students, if there's no captioning, you know, they rely on captioning. So if they just see one big long run-on sentence devoid of punctuation with no pauses or breaks or identification of the speaker, it makes it very hard to understand the captioning. And to make matters worse, the captioning isn't already always accurate, especially live transcription. So, you know, the 100% accuracy just doesn't exist. The other issue I think is maybe online learning itself. The students do they have access to the internet? Do they rely on the interpreter? Maybe the interpreter has accessing the internet. So there are a couple of situations that could impact that. So if the connection is choppy or freezes, you all are still able to hear the audio, but is the visual picture blurring because of bandwidth? So that's another issue that comes up. Access to support systems, say at a residential school for the deaf or a public school. Do they have access to the counselors, the faculty, all of those? Now they're at home, isolated. Where's their support and their access? Often they're the only deaf person in their family and in their own community. And often they meet people who, you know, just graduated from high school and they're shocked. They're like, oh, there are other deaf people in this community? I thought that I was the only deaf person in the world. They get out there in the world and they see other deaf people and they realize, you know, they haven't been given any language at all in learning ASL. So that is a huge challenge. The other thing to consider, for example, is accessibility to materials on LMS, on learning management systems. So for example, the University of Pittsburgh used to use Blackboard, I believe. I believe they've transitioned to Canvas now. Canvas, often teachers will post different podcasts, movies, media, and not realize that that media is not accessible. It doesn't have captioning. The deaf student can't access it the same way that their hearing peers can. So one of the biggest issues that we're facing currently is not just with the pandemic, but also with race. You know, there are some individuals in the deaf community that are of different subcultures as well. So, for example, Black, Indigenous people of color, a lot of them are, there are layers of issues and intersectionalities of oppression. Prejudice, racism, all of these things come to play. So all of those subcultures experience that. Deaf-blind students in a face-to-face, pardon the interpreter.
Kenneth, I don't want to cut you off, but maybe let's jump in and then we can come back to your thought. So it seems like we have identified a wide range of challenges facing folks with disabilities, right? Access to interpreters, mental health challenges, risks to physical health. And I think something that Kenneth said highlights, you know, for folks who work with people with disabilities, that's a leading principle, which is that it's also individualized and personalized, right? We can't slap the same Band-Aid on every situation and think that it's going to solve it. And so it's about understanding, right, these different contexts that people are operating in. So we've identified the risks, and I'm curious what you all have seen in terms of what are organizations, the government, universities like Pitt, what are they getting right? And what do they need to work on?
So this is Brad. I wanted to just highlight something that Kenny said that I think is really important and spot on. Is the fact that, you know, a lot of these problems have always existed, and the pandemic has just put a magnifying glass on them. And this, I think, is also an opportunity for us to do better in a lot of areas. You know, the fact that a lot of these problems have come to light gives us an opportunity to do better. And one area I think where we've made some strides is in hospital policies. You know, one of the things that the disability community has been advocating for is, you know, their rights in healthcare. And we've seen some major changes occur with hospital ethics policies evolving. UPMC, for example, you know, provided a new policy where individuals with disabilities can have a support person in the hospital with them, which is something that, you know, people have been advocating for that other places have been denied because of the pandemic. And I think we've seen in other places in the country where care has been rationed and there are, you know, potential civil rights and ethics violations for people with disabilities. And I think some states in particular are doing very well at creating more policies around human rights and civil rights.
Go ahead and jump in. A lot of what I kind of wrote down to say here has been mentioned, which is great. I would say that one of the things that's happening is that things are being adapted in ways that turn out to help everyone. There's kind of this universal design concept of lots of things right now that are helping everyone, that are absolutely helping with people with disabilities, but are really universally designed to work better for everyone. Things like flexibility on deadlines, you know, our taxes weren't due on April 15th or July 15th. That kind of helps everyone. Sometimes delays in deadlines for rent payments, increased availability of delivery services, as Heather mentioned. Of course, they come with a cost, so that's something that has to be factored in. Increased availability of telehealth. For people with disabilities who, especially right now, may not have access to safe transportation. I know that's certainly an issue for me when thinking about, is it safe for me to, because I can't jump in my own car and drive, is it safe for me to take the bus right now? I'm not really feeling like that's super safe. Is it safe to take an Uber? Well, maybe, as long as I'm willing to self-advocate and ask the Uber driver to wear their mask, which they don't always do. You know, and I would say just overall increase in flexibility, and maybe we think about the word accommodations in a broader sense, where heretofore accommodations have kind of meant working specifically, providing specific services and supports for people with disabilities. But, you know, right now we all really need to be accommodated, I would say. And that's something that just has kind of been happening, although it's starting to maybe decrease a little bit as people start to open things up and the expectations for what people ought to be able to do or maybe going back to pre-pandemic phase.
This is Heather. So to kind of add to what Catherine was saying, I think, so in Pennsylvania here, we had the option for everyone to vote by mail and the option to vote in person. And I think it's those options like that that are really important, because not only for the general public, but even to accommodate the needs of different disabilities. So for someone like me, often a virtual meeting is easier than an in-person one, because that formula of figuring out the transportation and will the building be accessible, will there be parking nearby, that can be more difficult. So Zoom meetings are great for me. For someone who is deaf, that clearly isn't always easier. So even within disabilities, you really need that flexibility. And so I'm cautiously hopeful that is what Pitt is trying to implement for, you know, the fall and who knows, past the fall semester, where you have the option of in-person classes where it's possible, and you have the option of virtual classes for students who don't feel comfortable being in an in-person environment. I think that is what's really important that we are doing, and that we make sure we keep doing that. And I think even beyond pandemics, those options in place.
So I think the best way that we can approach this situation is not to make assumptions about things, but best be prepared in advance and know who our students are and communicate with those specific students and ask them what they need, what accommodation would they prefer, and keep informed about, you know, how the students are being supported.
This is Brad again. I just wanted to add, there's a lot of questions I think popping up about technology. And I think that technology is evolving quickly during this pandemic to support a lot of different great remote features that help people with disabilities and all of us. But the rate at which technology is advancing within medicine isn't quite as fast. You know, there's lots of issues with HIPAA compliance where we can't use certain technologies within a medical setting. Not all of the telemedicine systems that we're using in a medical setting are fully accessible anywhere near some of the other technologies being used outside the system. And so I think that also presents some challenges to the ways that we're able to deliver care. If we need, you know, an interpreter, if we need closed captioning, those can be very difficult to get sometimes. Very quickly. So you may be limited as to how much urgent type care you can provide to somebody in need. And, you know, we see that there's limitations as to who can be involved in some of those visits. Sometimes we need to include caregivers who are at different places, who are outside the system, or a vendor who's providing assistive technology. And some of the limitations of technology at this point are that you can't always involve the people in the visit that you need to. And so I see there's lots of opportunities for technology to evolve to support the models of care that we really need.
And this is Kenneth again. So yes, technology, I think, is a double-edged sword. So there are many pros. There's also a lot of cons. Personally, I use hearing aids. I've got these. I use it as a tool. But there are a lot of people that have specific technology, then they think it's a cure or a solution, but it's not always. I just wanted to throw out that point there. We can think of how we view that technology and how we approach that when we work with people.
So through this discussion, we've had a lot of opportunity to talk about what good can come of the pandemic, various opportunities that we've discussed that have sort of come through this crisis, such as Catherine mentioned, universal design concepts, some more consideration of flexibility and how we function in our world, from considering late payments to withholding monthly bills for various reasons. Heather mentioned the opportunity to vote by mail. So how do you see, what opportunities do you see at the moment to allow these to continue through this pandemic? So as we still continue to navigate the pandemic, how can we make sure that there's an opportunity to continue to change? What opportunities can we seize as it relates to people with disabilities?
This is Kenneth. I've been thinking about that. And one thing that I've noticed in society is that our way of life has drastically changed. And that 6-foot rule and keeping distancing from people and how we keep our distance and all of that. And maybe we should be seizing that as an opportunity to think about how we can include universal design. And how we include accessibility in our design as we're redesigning it at the same time, approaching that with the approach to the coronavirus, but taking this opportunity to include that in our new way of designing things.
I can jump in. This is Catherine. From an educational standpoint, you can imagine that forced online and remote instruction has absolutely turned higher education on its head. And while there are many classes, chemistry lab, drama class, biology lab, art class, et cetera, that are pretty difficult to teach remotely, there are many classes that have discovered some interesting opportunities. And I'll be very interested to see, as we return, knock on wood, hopefully soon, to in-person instruction, what does that do to the method of instruction, at least for certain classes? Are there more online components? Are there Zoom meetings and in person? Are there sort of hybrid model kinds of things? So that's a really interesting opportunity that I look forward to seeing how that plays out. Another one, which Brad kind of touched on a little bit, is telehealth is a huge opportunity for people with disabilities to have easier access to care in a way that does not necessarily involve them arranging transportation, arranging all kinds of things that would allow them to get to a medical appointment in person. And I would just say in general, our society exploring the different ways that we interact with each other that may not be face-to-face, and can we find rich, meaningful interactions with each other that may allow us to kind of be the global community that we really are across the world. I know that for me, just not related to my disability, but this has really been an interesting opportunity for me to make some connections with friends throughout the world. And that's, they're on Zoom, whether they're in the next house over or in Iraq. So it's just been a really interesting time.
So this is Heather. I think for me, one of the things that I am hopeful that continues is the realization that working from home is something that can be beneficial, and people can still be productive when they do that as an option for everyone and not just thought of as a perk or as an accommodation, because it can be exhausting to have to advocate for that as a real accommodation when people, the first thought is, oh, people just want to work from home because it's easier and it's a perk and it shouldn't be an option off the bat. But I think what we've seen over, you know, the last few months is that for many, not for all, but for many, it actually is possible. And it's maybe smoother than companies would have thought. Now, am I saying that I think everyone should work from home now on forever? Absolutely not. But I hope that it remains an option and an easier option that doesn't require, you know, a hard sell to make it an option.
This is Brad. Heather, I think that's a great point. And I wonder what your thoughts are on whether the opportunity to work at home opens up more opportunities for people with disabilities to have new employment, you know, new employment opportunities that didn't exist before. And maybe that's something through vocational rehabilitation programs could be advocated for. It seems like a lot of companies now are realizing, you know, they don't need to have as much office space. They can have their workforce at home. And I would hope that would open up a lot of employment opportunities.
This is Heather. And just to kind of follow up on that, because I think that's a really important point. Because when I recently started a new job, my current job, just a few months ago. And when I was job searching, I had to look within a very, very, very small mile radius because of the kind of the complicated logistics of transportation and my needs and my day. I knew that for it to be feasible, I really needed to look within a small, you know, real estate area. So had I known that the option for working from home would be possible at other companies, it really would have expanded my options. And I'm sure the options of many people who have more mobility-based disabilities.
It's definitely given us all an opportunity to reconsider how we do our work. And so it is hopeful that as we move forward, we can look back on how we've all been able to continue in our roles and potentially, as Dr. DeCiano mentioned, open up more opportunities for individuals with disabilities who maybe previously have not been able to find employment due to transportation and other limitations. So that is hopeful. So I wanted to ask the panelists, what are some ways to advocate for essential services and treatment for the disability community at this time and as we move forward?
This is Brad. So I think we just need to listen to what people need. I think we need to, you know, advocate for universal design and accessibility in all services and technologies that are being used in the medical areas. This is a great time for, you know, having all of those systems to evolve. And I also think that we need to continue to advocate from a policy perspective, you know, to make sure that when people are getting care in a facility, they have access to a caregiver or a support person if that's needed. And, you know, their rights are being respected just as anyone else's would be. So I think there are, you know, some areas of the country where, you know, that needs to evolve much more quickly to come up to speed with other places.
This is Kenneth.
Oh, go ahead, Kenneth.
Yes, so related to what Brad was just mentioning, including individuals who are affecting policies, using deaf people as representatives. I've often noticed where there are a lot of policy being made and initiated, things like that design is helpful to have that support from the deaf community. And what's missing is a deaf representative or representation in that environment. There's a lot of people who are impacted by that process as well and should be a part of that conversation.
This is Catherine. I'll just add, this feels like a time when in a way, if you think about it, we all have a disability. We're all limited in how much we can travel. Where is it safe for us to go and to be? We're all maybe more reliant on others than ever before. We're reliant on others to wear their mask, to social distance, you know, to practice safe things so that we can all be safe. And that's something that, as we've opened up, I think a couple of people have mentioned that's been increasingly challenging for us to navigate. People are leaving their masks at home and they're wearing them improperly and all kinds of things are going on. And we're learning that we all, whether we have a disability or not, we all have to self-advocate more than ever. I'll just give you a quick example. I have a friend from out of town who wanted to come and stay with me for a couple of days. And ordinarily I would have been absolutely, you know, mi casa su casa, your house is my house. But this time I had to say, well, what's your philosophy on social distancing? And he had to say, well, I really haven't been doing it. And I had to self-advocate and say, I'm really sorry. As much as I would love for you to come visit, this is not safe. We can't do that. And that's something that I think while people with disabilities are really have varying degrees of comfort, but many of us have a lot of comfort with self-advocacy, that's not something that everyone is comfortable with. And so we're all kind of learning to do that. And we're all formerly able-bodied, now people with, you know, variety of coronavirus-related limitations. And we're all experiencing the kinds of things that sometimes people with disabilities experience on a regular basis. So that's an opportunity, I think, for us as people with disabilities to help people be educated, you know, that this is what we go through on a day-to-day basis. We're experts at this. We're experts at navigating these, how to advocate, and just helping other people have a better understanding of what we deal with. And maybe sometimes that can open up a conversation, a greater conversation about accessibility and universal design.
This is Heather. So I think this is where Hannah's earlier point about not assuming really is important to remember. So when you have that representation of people with disabilities, you really need to ask them what the priorities are, because what I have found often, not just in pandemic times, but in all times, is that people really misprioritize what my access needs are. So you end up with well-intentioned policies that don't actually play out logistically at all. You end up with rules where you have an accessible bathroom inside the building, but a step to get into that building. Really well-intentioned, really poorly designed in practice. So I think it is really important to ask. I think, you know, you talk about transportation, people will say, oh, sure, that's just important for everyone, so we don't need to get representation of people with disabilities. But people with disabilities have very unique transportation needs. And if you make sure that you're including their representation from the outset, you won't have to go back and retrofit and redo policies and carve out really special exemptions that then the people with disabilities constantly have to advocate and say, no, actually, I am allowed to do this. You might not know because it's not commonly taught, but it is allowed. So really making sure that you're asking questions at the outset and giving people with disabilities a place to speak and really be listened to.
And this is Kenneth again. I agree with Catherine and Heather. Both have made some great points. I think it's also something to consider. Self-advocacy is important. Asking people is important too. But before you ask, look at your own privilege and think about, you know, that privilege as a mask. And that really becomes a problem. So for example, if you ask a deaf person, hey, can you read lips? Then you're sort of putting the responsibility and the burden on that deaf person. And it's not really a halfway solution. You're not meeting them halfway with that. So my question, is that coming from a place of privilege or a genuine place of, I'm not sure how to accommodate you? So we have to look at both perspectives of that and how we're asking as a self-advocate, and also how do you work with me as a person with a disability? So for me, that's what's most important.
All right, terrific, thank you. So that concludes the questions that we had for the panelists. At this point, we'd like to move into some of the questions that have been posed by our attendees. So first I'd like to ask a question that comes. It says, I am wondering if there are recommendations for public and other transit advocacy for people with disabilities in the Pittsburgh region and on the Pitt-Oakland campus in particular, also in the context of COVID-19. Thank you.
I can speak to that. This is Kenneth. I could add one thing that for sure, Pitt for deaf people. It's just speaking from my own experience. I do remember traveling in Europe, and one thing that I was just floored by was that all of the bus systems had the LED reader screens, like where the next stop was, it would tell you, or what the name of the bus station was. And as it was written, scrolled across an LED screen at the front of the bus. And it was, you know, captioned with announcements. And occasionally, the loudspeaker, our next stop is blah, blah, blah. I don't know where that's at. I don't know where I'm at because I am at because I can't hear the announcements. So that is another really important factor to consider in terms of universal design and making sure that everything's accessible, including the bus stops, that there's a captioned, or if it's Braille, things like that. Is there a ramp to on and get on and off the bus?
Okay, great. Another question we received is, understanding the social safety net holds us all in a variety of ways. There's a significant segment of persons with disabilities who live in deep poverty. These persons do not have access to computers, cannot even begin to afford an Uber, and have major food insecurity issues. How do we know and support these persons in a dignified way? How can we make sure their stories and experiences are shared, heard, and responded to?
So this is Heather. I think this is where advocacy and policy are really important, and helping those stories get to the right policymakers. I think many, many people do not realize what living on disability means financially, and that it is almost impossible to do so. And I think that we need greater advocacy for those people because it's hard to navigate the system when you don't know what questions to ask and who to go to for answers. And the policies that exist right now are really segmented and really confusing. I've had years of experience trying to navigate them. I have a really supported family and medical team, and it's still a challenge for me. So I can't even imagine what it would be like without that support system in place. So I think the important thing to do is really to bring those stories into the light and really strongly advocate for a change in policies to help people really truly just live and get their basic needs met financially while living with a disability.
So another question from the audience is asking for the panelists to speak to the pros and cons of using masks during this time for people with disabilities, especially for people who are deaf and hard of hearing. Are there other safety measures to consider instead of masks in those contexts?
So this is
I think I already mentioned this a little bit. This is Kenneth, but it's a tough question because, you know, lip reading implies that, you know, like research from books, that it's, you know, it's the same as like reading a book. It's a resource to use. It's, you know, they find that about 25 to 40% of sound is visible on your lips of what's being said. So, and a lot of it is in the back of your mouth or in your throat. So, you know, do we have to lip read? You know, I don't know about that 25 to 40%. So the rest of it is used using, we figured out using clues when we're lip reading. So body language, facial expressions. So the masks become a challenge, and it's not just the lip reading, but that it covers half of your face. And we use facial expressions as part of our grammar structure. So, you know, and we're also good at catching things like social cues. And when we look at somebody's face, so if you've got a mask covering half of that, you're really not, you're getting an incomplete canvas of what they're saying. So yeah.
And this is Brad. I just wanted to add that there are some advances now where people are developing some masks that you can see through. Now, how well they will work, we're not quite sure, because they can fog up and they still, you know, limit your mouth movement to some extent. Another option for some folks who either need better lip reading through a mask or who can't wear a mask themselves is a face shield. So that's another possibility. But unfortunately, I think what we have presently still poses some limitations.
This is Kenneth again. So one tool that I've been thinking about, you know, gesturing, writing back and forth, you know, while keeping your distance. There's an app, Google Translate. You can text back and forth, and it'll do a speech to text to the deaf person and recognize your voice so that it can type what you're saying to them. I mean, it's pretty good. It's not bad. Often it's clear enough of a message. That is one alternate solution as well.
So another question, and I think this comes from the fact that at various points during this conversation, you know, we've talked about universal design and having options available for everyone. And so they asked, do you think the solutions that are aimed at one size fits all could hinder people with disabilities, wasting monetary resources and human resources that could better be utilized on a more individual basis? So I think it's this question of balancing, how do we balance, right, the need for individualized versus these more universal design principles?
This is Catherine. I'll take a stab at that. I think that's always the question with regard to universal design, is that while helping a lot of people, it doesn't help everyone. And sometimes you run into the issue where someone may think that something's been designed universally or accessibly, and therefore it must work for everyone. And so that person for whom it does not work may get the response of, well, why doesn't it work for you? You know, this is designed to be accessible. So I think we just have to pair that with education of what universal design can and cannot do, and, you know, its limits. And I think people who work in universal design really understand that, but it unfortunately has the linguistic label of universal. And so universal really isn't universal for everyone. Something that, you know, like the universal design of, say, wearing masks is great, unless you are a person who's deaf or hard of hearing and needs to lip read as part of, to supplement your communication, as Kenny said. So I think you hit on something. I don't think it's a reason not to use universal design, but it is a limitation for sure.
This is Heather. So I think the issue with requiring individualized solutions rather than universal design as a starting point is that people then have the person with the disability has the onus of knowing what the individualized special options are and seeking them out and making sure that they have access to them. That is incredibly challenging and difficult, and makes the person with the disability do a lot more work to find out what options might be available to them if they ask the right question to the right person at the right time. So I think universal design is certainly not perfect. And I think you still need flexibility after universal design to allow for the people for whom universal design is not really universal, but it's a better starting point than building something that works for able-bodied people and requiring people with disabilities to seek out the alternative themselves.
I think a lot of the research shows that universal design concepts benefit all individuals. And so certainly starting as that as the platform, the principles of universal design as the platform can certainly look to benefit all different types of individuals within the environment, the academic environment in particular. So in a similar vein, there was a question regarding website accessibility as it relates to learning. So what are the top problems that users have? Software scans do not find all of the issues that people experience. Feedback from this panel would be fantastic.
Sure, I will. This is Catherine. I'll give this one a try. I think I can fairly confidently say that probably closed captioning and otherwise making videos accessible is perhaps the biggest barrier, only because it's something that people perceive as having a very high cost, and it can have a very high cost depending on how you do it, or it can have a much lower cost, especially if you caption as you go and you provide interpreting as you go and audio description and all that kind of thing as you go. But I can say that from my perspective, when we learned that Carnegie Mellon was going to be moving to an online learning environment, the first thing that I did was to immediately make sure that our captioning company that we use was available to caption for a few more students who were going to need captioning over Zoom but did not need it live. And also to make sure that all the technical issues were worked out so that when classes returned, that the captioning was ready to go. So that's a big issue, and it's something that sometimes gets overlooked, I think. And then certainly, obviously, making sure that the web-based interfaces that students are using are accessible, that they have all of the kind of web content accessibility 2.1 guidelines being met. Probably isn't the panel to really go into the nitty-gritty of what that looks like, but there are tons of resources. So if you're looking to learn more about that and you want to Google web content accessibility guidelines, that can give you a good start to what those guidelines are, what they look like, and even some resources for making content, digital content, accessible.
This is Heather. I think also when we talk about websites and accessibility, we also need to talk about social media websites accessibility, because often the accommodations and the tend to lag behind the general new updates that they put out. So, and I think right now people are spending maybe more time on social media to connect because they can't as easily connect in person. So on Instagram, you have the option of doing alt text for your images so that a screen reader will pick it up, but it's hidden behind a number of options that you have to click through to find it. Instagram stories are really popular right now, but there's no captions built in. So if you have a video, you need to have also a caption app and type it in. Instagram doesn't build it in itself. Twitter last week, I believe, put out a new feature where you could tweet a voice recording. But again, they did not build in captions. And so there was a huge, huge outcry. And they apologized and said in the future they'll work to make sure accessibility needs are met from the beginning and not afterwards. And so I think it's important that we think about those modes of connection, and that again, when new features and new updates happen to these websites, that we're sure that all of the accessibility needs are being met before they're debuted and not after when they realize that they missed out on something. And that's where it's really important to have that representation in the room, because if people with disabilities were on those teams working as engineers. It's something that could have been pointed out a long time ago.
And this is Kenneth. So, yeah, as Heather mentioned, I agree, definitely. I think often the big problem is that people are reactive and not proactive in their development. So I think you'll find, you know, it's strange where if we're proactive, there's this first sense that, oh, that's a lot of work. But honestly, it's an investment of time. If you post a picture and you've got the image description in there, then, you know, in the long run, that's your investment and it's already established as your practice. But if you wait until later when these issues come up, you'll realize you've actually created more work for yourself in the long run.
So as much as I'd love to stay on the topic of web accessibility, I'm going to take us down a slightly different path. And this was posed more as a statement, but I think there's an important question. So one of our audience members talked a bit about the experience of having a child with various developmental delays, receiving services. And so if anybody has any thoughts about how to deal with and recover from the disruption in necessary services that I think so many young people with disabilities are experiencing right now.
This is Heather. I can say broad strokes and not details, but I do know that Pennsylvania's Office of Developmental Programs has been doing a lot for caregivers of many children, I believe, with autism and with other developmental delays. And their website would be a great place to start. They also have a call-in phone number where family caregivers can call and talk to someone, not a 911 emergency call-in, but just to have support and resources and connections.
So in a similar spirit to that, we received a question from an attendee who states, faculty time, stamina, and mental health seem to be among the biggest obstacles to create the most effective online or hybrid learning experience for students. Given hiring freezes and other complications universities are facing, some faculty don't have much notice sometimes regarding which courses they are teaching, so they don't always have as much time as they'd like to make course content accessible and potent across student needs. What advice do you have for those individuals who have limited time and resources? Sorry, I went back into the web accessibility, Angie, world.
Hi, well, this is Catherine. I'll try to give this a shot. It's certainly something that is a very real issue and absolutely in the spring when we, you know, within about a week went boom, we're all of a sudden online. I think in the short term, you know, working through individual situations, if students have particular accessibility needs, working with, you know, at Pitt, the Office of Disability Resources and Services or the equivalent organization, wherever you may happen to be, whatever higher education institution you may be in. Long-term though, this is a real opportunity for faculty as you have bandwidth, I stress that, if you have bandwidth to really learn more about digital accessibility. And sometimes universities have offices of, like we have our Everly Center for Teaching and Learning at Carnegie Mellon. Those resources may be able to advise faculty on accessibility, kind of best practices and key points. There are some things that you can do that really don't take a lot of time. I think it's probably beyond the scope of this panel to really delve very deeply into that question. But I would say in the short term, really working closely with anybody at your university that works on digital accessibility and works on providing disability accommodations to make sure that individual students' needs are met, and then exploring out into the broader kind of accessibility landscape or arena.
This is Heather. go ahead.
You go ahead, Heather.
Oh, he's been short. I think that just in times where it is a time crunch and there's not much lead up time, just letting your students know that you're open and flexible to helping them get their needs met, not reaching out specifically to people with disabilities, but reaching out to the whole class and saying, I feel free to come to me or to the disability office or whoever the right person is, and let me know what your needs are and what would be helpful to you to get them met, and go a long way to helping students feel like they are welcomed and being heard, and that they can make those asks without feeling like they're overstepping.
And this is Kenneth here. Great. Yeah, I just wanted to add, Heather's correct. I think one of the most important things is flexibility. And for me as a faculty myself, I can empathize for sure. It's, you know, the fact is we face a lot of oppression and different expectations and responsibilities, and it's tough, and I get that. And a couple things I wanted to throw out: flexibility, absolutely. And trying to remember that you're not the only one who's facing those challenges. The students have got them too. They're facing a lot of those challenges. So if you two, both of you work together on being flexible, I think it can make your task a lot easier. The other thing being that, you know, it's important to consider different approaches. So, for example, personally, I think that asynchronous learning works best. It's most effective for us to start with that the first week and build the course. And once that's established, allowing the students to learn at their own pace while we're starting to build the next week and having more of a structure to it, but also at the same time making sure that it's 100% accessible. So, you know, that's personally worked for me, because you can ask yourself, you know, what's the best approach for you? Is it going to be asynchronous? Is it going to be synchronous? Is it going to be a hybrid of those two? So that's something to really think about.
So we have a couple questions aimed at specific panelists. So this one is for Brad, asking if you can speak to why standard issue platforms like Zoom, Skype, Teams are not HIPAA compliant, which you might not have, be able to speak specifically to that, but then what implications do you see for telemedicine when that's a necessity for certain disabled populations during the pandemic?
Sure. So there's a whole list of requirements that a technology has to meet in order to be HIPAA compliant. And it has to do a lot with how data is stored and exchanged and the risk that your personal information could be breached. So there could be a confidentiality issue if the technology isn't really handling your private information in a safe way. We've seen that recently with Zoom, for example, where, you know, we call it Zoom bombing, where people can get into a meeting very easily, and you wouldn't want that to occur, obviously, if you're having a medical appointment and you're discussing, you know, private information. So during the pandemic, CMS, Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services, has given a waiver where we can use non-HIPAA compliant technologies for medical services, but while that opens up access, it also poses an issue and brings up the point where, you know, why weren't these technologies built with HIPAA compliance in mind from the beginning? So as we move forward, I think it's more important to start thinking about HIPAA compliance and accessibility both as we're developing technologies. And the other issue I see is that, you know, these technologies don't integrate, obviously, with our medical record. So ideally, you want to use a technology when you're interfacing with a medical professional, so they can also be in your chart at the same time, so all of the data is available and you can communicate in a variety of different ways, share resources, patient education. So there's still a ways to go, even though we have some benefits during the pandemic. It doesn't solve the ultimate issue that these technologies really aren't appropriate in the long run for medical care.
And then a question for Kenneth. That's a two-part question. It says, what are the biggest challenges for you when participating virtually in a meeting as opposed to in person? And even if they are top-notch, do ASL interpreters have similar or different challenges? It says, pardon me, as this second part violates taking the interpreter out of interpreting. So they're asking Jen for your perspective as well.
So yeah, sorry, I had to, if you could repeat the first part of the question, I want to make sure I don't go off track.
Yeah, so it just, they're asking for what are the biggest challenges for you participating virtually as opposed to in person?
I think it's important to remember in the beginning, we had mentioned that when you're talking about someone who's deaf, that includes a variety of individuals, someone who's born deaf, someone who is post-lingually deaf, someone who's hard of hearing. So the experience in that varies depending on the person. For me personally, I'm not representative of all of the experiences, so keep that in mind. However, personally for me, one of the biggest challenges is often that I am bilingual. I am fluent in both languages, both English and ASL. So often I'll be signing, and that means that the interpreter has got to figure out what word choice to use. And often, really, I wanted an alternative word choice. But if it's a specific word choice that has a huge impact on my intention or on my message or how I convey it, that can be a difference of how people perceive my message or the worth based on the interpreter, not based on me personally and who I am and what I meant to say. So I definitely prefer to communicate directly in my target language, so whatever that might be. If they're using English, I would prefer to communicate with them in English. If a person's using ASL, I prefer to communicate with them in ASL. That can be a challenge. I think I answered that. Does that answer the question? I felt like I went on a little bit. What was the second part of the question?
I think it's just a question of whether that experience is different online than in person. And it sounds like you have less flexibility to choose that communication type that you would prefer in an online environment.
They're pretty similar. The thing that affects it would be the technology. So for example, we were just saying, you know, if we have a Zoom meeting with a doctor, if I can see the doctor clearly, that's great. If the interpreter's freezing, that means it's a difference. That affects our communication because the doctor's clear, but the interpreter is not. Also, I do remember, I think I mentioned, I had said that, I had taken some cough syrup, but the interpreter thought that I had a serious, you know, cough. And so the doctor was terribly concerned about that because that's, you know, obviously a symptom of coronavirus or COVID-19. So that became belabored, but that wasn't what I meant. I took the cough syrup because I had a sore throat, not because I had a cough. And that communication minor point caused a major miscommunication. And plus combined with the interpreter signal freezing and being choppy. So there's a difference with the technology. Could that happen in person? Sure. But the technology aside, it's more fluent in person, and it's face-to-face is always more efficient. And, you know, that's a big issue that the community is facing today because the hospitals are using a lot of video remote interpreting, and it's VRI. So, and opinions vary on that, but I think most deaf people prefer face-to-face and having a live interpreter than having an interpreter on a video screen that's video remote.
And then the second part of the question, Jen, was to you, if you feel comfortable talking about your experience as an interpreter and how that might be different or challenging in a virtual environment.
And unfortunately, as the interpreter working interpreting right now, I'm not able to respond. Kenneth's saying yes. So I could probably mention that again, I don't speak for the interpreting community, but I do know that interpreters, it's a tough field. It's a tough job. There's a lot of things have got to be done on the spot spontaneously and live interpreting and simultaneous interpreting. So you have to consider, you know, the different levels of language proficiency, different sign variants within the community and local dialects. So, and interpreters have to know all of those specific jargon that goes with each field, whether it's medical or legal terminology. So yes, that's a challenge too.
So we are running out of time. A question that has us, I think, leads nicely into the end and has us thinking forward is, as we continue to move forward and adapt to COVID-19 pandemic, what are some suggestions you can provide to the audience to ensure that the university and the greater community is providing advocacy for people with disabilities during these uncertain times?
This is Catherine. I would just say continue with town halls like this one, where you're kind of listening and then implement, you know, any recommendations as applicable to the university. Obviously, we've talked a lot about things outside of university spaces, but a lot of those things are applicable to university policies. And so just listening, learning, and acting, and all of those things are important. So listening and learning are good, but only if followed up by taking substantial actions that take into account the feedback of those who have shared.
This is Brad. I would also say that, you know, if you are a student or a staff member or a faculty member at the university, look locally within your department or school. If you have a committee that deals with diversity, inclusion, accessibility, certainly there are ones at the university level. We have the Advocacy Committee for Inclusion and Accessibility. And so you can always bring ideas and problems to those committees to, you know, take higher up in the university. There are a lot of people who are advocating and involved currently.
And this is Kenneth. So I think one important thing to keep in mind for the future is just making sure that really anywhere you work, whatever environment that may be, whether it's a university or at an organization, it's important to have one point of contact and to keep that channel open. So for the University of Pittsburgh, they've got disability resources and services, and they've done a great job. That's a very open channel, and it has access to people for what services they need to communicate with them. And this town hall too has been one great example, but unfortunately, sometimes isn't true for many places. One statistic that has stuck with me over the years is that universities and colleges in the United States have about 200,000 deaf or hard of hearing individuals in total. And studies are finding that 74% of that population is considered they consider online learning harder because there is less access to resources that they need. So it's important to make sure that your services are open and easily accessible for the people who need them.
This is Heather. I think even going beyond making sure that the Office of Disability or whatever the appropriate office is available and easy to contact, I think also making sure that they are represented in the rooms where the decisions are being made about policies and how the university should move forward, because I think they are the biggest advocacy voice for their students and their staff and faculty with disabilities. And that is a way for those people to know that they are being represented in these important decisions and in how they'll be communicated to the community.
So we are just about out of time. So on behalf of Lee and I and everybody who's been behind these town halls, Rana Doko, I just want to say thank you to our panelists for participating. Thank you to everybody for joining. And plug our next town hall, which is on July 8th. It is a toxic recipe, the historical ingredients of American inequity. So we hope that you all will join us there. We also, as you can see on my virtual background, have a diversity forum coming up at the end of July that is open to all members of the community, alum. So we hope folks will join us as we continue these types of conversations.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.